Pozdrav svima. Ja sam Zoran Nikolic, autor knjige The Atlas of Unusual Languages. Wait, what? Did you not understand this introduction that I made in Serbian? I just greeted you from Serbia and introduced myself. I am Zoran Nikolic, the author of the book The Atlas of Unusual Languages. But I already knew that most of you would not understand this greeting. On the entire planet Earth, less than 25 million people speak Serbian and several very close and similar languages. The remaining nearly 8 billion people speak another language, most notably English, Chinese, Hindustani, Spanish, Portuguese, Russian, Arabic, German, and hundreds of other languages, large and small. It is these small languages and various lesser-known languages that are the main theme of my book, The Atlas of the Unusual Languages. Let us now imagine that I greeted you in some other language, for example, language called Kusunda. Do you know how many people would understand me? Believe it or not, there is a less than 100 people today that have some knowledge, basic knowledge, of the Kusunda language. They all live in Asian state of Nepal. The situation is similar with the language called Nihali, spoken in just one small area in central India, or language called Burushaski, whose speakers, the Burusha or Hansa people, live in northern Pakistan. Interestingly, there are numerous unconfirmed stories and legends which claim that the members of this Burusha people live extremely long and healthy lives. Is it true? Well, I thought you'd be curious about that, same as I was, so I wrote it about in my book. You should read it. In addition to those generally little known languages, I have also written some texts about very common languages such as German and English. And yes, these languages can also be considered as unusual languages in some cases, in the sense that they're being spoken in some most unexpected places. For example, English is the official language of the in an island Mediterranean country, as well on the strategic important peninsula on the border of Mediterranean and the Atlantic Ocean. And both of those places, that island and that peninsula, are more than 200 kilometers away from the UK. Even further, there are a small number of English speakers that live on one large Spanish-speaking island in the Caribbean. You should read about that too. On the other hand, you can also find German speakers in a large number of settlements near the Canadian and American border, but also in some countries in Central and South America. Even less expected, German is spoken in a village in New Zealand, but also on an island of Papua New Guinea. Certainly, the average German from Germany would find it very difficult to understand these distant dialects, but nevertheless, it is German language. And why did I decide to write this book in the first place? To be honest, I'm not 100% sure myself, but I believe that the fact that I was born and raised in Yugoslavia had a great impact. You know, Yugoslavia was a multinational state in which about 20 languages were spoken, and all were official, some at the level of the entire state, some only in certain municipalities, cities, villages, but there were more than 20 official languages in former Yugoslavia. As a child and a speaker of the Serbo-Croatian language, it was fascinating for me that I could occasionally watch news or cultural shows on the state television in Hungarian, Albanian, Slovak, Ruthenian, Romanian, and many other languages. Today, most of the inhabitants of the former Yugoslavia can consider themselves, polyglots, because they, after the disintegration of Yugoslavia, that led to disintegration of its largest language, Serbo-Croatian, into four languages that are used today: Serbian, Croatian, Bosnian, and Montenegrin. For speakers of any of these languages, the remaining three are almost completely intelligible. Such an environment with a large number of languages has led me to interest in searching for linguistic oddities around the world. When I saw how much information I had gathered, I began to organize it and realized that there was enough material for a book. Thus began the writing of the Atlas of Unusual Languages. I hope that all readers will find this book interesting as a collection of short but informative texts, convenient for reading in a train or a plane, in the evening with a glass of your favorite drink, or on a beach, terrace, park, wherever you think it's the most convenient for you. For anyone interested in the more fun geography-related text, I would also recommend that my first book, called The Atlas of Unusual Borders, both of these books, Borders and Languages, represent a kind of a whole or a set for anyone who is interested in unusual languages of people surrounded by unusual borders. Thank you.